and welcome to another episode of Literary Gladiators, the show where we discuss and debate literature in all of its forms. If it's written work, it's game. Let's meet the panel.
Hello, I'm Larry.
I'm Jesse.
I'm Tori.
And I'm Josh. And today we are going to be going over one of Tori's favorite writers, but he's more notably known as a playwright, and that is William Shakespeare. The play that we're going to be going over today is a comedy. This is the first time we've ever gone over a comedy on our show. We've gone over his tragedies and his sonnets. And this one is A Midsummer Night's Dream, which, Tori, you said that, or you were, you did an interpretation, a sign language interpretation?
Yeah, I've actually had two performances that I was able to be involved with this. A couple years ago, I was part of a community theater group, and I got to play Puck, which was really cool, being able to do the one Hecate monologue where he howls at the moon. Under a blue moon, so that was pretty fun. And then I also got the opportunity to interpret this play. I'm in an interpreting for American Sign Language interpreting program at a community college nearby. And it's a really fun play to unpack because that was a whole other level of like decode. So you think you have to decode it reading it, but then you had to decode it from like that language into another language. So there was a whole other level of being able to really delve into the script and the language and find which parts that you get to keep and which parts translate, because surprisingly, ASL and Shakespeare go very well hand in hand, no pun intended. A couple little fun facts. This play, the first play that the script version that is written in an imprint was from like 1595, 1596, somewhere around there. Mm-hmm. So we've had a lot of time to be able to, from a literary standpoint and from a criticism standpoint, talk about this play. Mm-hmm. And it's a play that has a play within a play, so that means that halfway through the play, there's another group of actors that come in and say, hey, we're going to start doing a play, and then there's actually the play within the play that happens. Mm-hmm. It has a couple of different arcs. The three main arcs are the four young lovers that run around out in the woods, Hippolyta and Theseus, which is a king and a queen, and their marriage, and then Oberon and Titania, and all of the fairies that are involved with that. It's not, I'd say, a substantive play. Like, you know, you look at King Lear or any of the other plays that Shakespeare has written, and it's got form, it's got something depth. It's got depth. This play has depth. I mean, it has the usual Shakespeare depth where it has fun playing with characters and time and stuff like that. But it doesn't, I feel like the only play fluffier than this is probably Love's Labor's Lost, which makes no sense whatsoever. It's just a bunch of people going, I love you, but I can't do anything because I've made a rule because I'm a king. But that's neither here nor there. I found probably one of the funniest quotes about the play. It was written in 1662. It's one of the first critic, a writer by the name of Samuel Pepys. He was like a literary critic.
Yeah,
it was the first thing that he wrote, and he said it was the most insipid, ridiculous play that he had ever seen. And I find that to be the funniest thing when you think about it, because in 1662, that play had been around for a good 100 years at that point in time, and he was this is frivolous and ridiculous, and I think it is stupid.
And he's right.
You fast forward to today, and you have all of these different things, and I tried to write down all the different things and reasons the play exists. Classism, feminism, racism, we have youth, freedom of thought, dreamscapes, sexuality, exploration of sexuality, control of sexuality, control of the youth. Like, there are so many different things that people have tried to say that this play is about.
I think just about every Shakespeare play controls the youth. It's always, just about every play is a king and a queen.
He has a formula. You don't break what works. Like, you got something, and it's also based off of, like, these plays are not original to him. These are based off of other fairy tales and oral stories that were passed down to him that he's heard. So, you know, nothing is new. Everything is recycled in a different and funky way. So what I wanted to do is, based off of the fact that no matter where in the timeline of this play existing, you look, either it's a terrible play or it's a wonderful play and it's thought-provoking, or it's insipid, vapid, and frothy. What did you guys think the play was about?
I think it was about love and kind of the power of love to rule you know, your life, like, on an emotional level that is not reasonable or irrational. I think it's like the power of desire and wanting someone, and how that can, you know, really put a lot of havoc on somebody's life. And it's almost, you know, with the idea of Cupid, where it's like an uncontrollable urge.
And Puck makes an interesting Cupid.
Oh boy, does he ever.
You know what you were saying earlier about how they said, you know, how insipid it was. In the last line of the play.
I love that.
In the last line of the play, you know, where it's Puck and talking to the audience pretty much, right? And he pretty much says, you know, this.
If we shadows,
don't take this too seriously.
Yeah. Think but this and all is mended. Think but those who have but slumbered here and these shadows did appear. Like, he's basically saying, like, if you didn't like it, just imagine it was a dream. Hey. Like,
yeah. So it's like Shakespeare.
I'd rather be dreaming of Wonderland.
It's like he wanted to take a chance and do something different. And, you know, so I think that it was self-aware in that way. Really.
I think it is a very self-aware play. I think that if you look at all of the characters, I think Bottom counts as Shakespeare. I think he looks, and this is something that I saw other written texts as support for this, is his character kind of comes in and is very confident in what he does and talks about being an actor and being the portrayal of all these different things.
He's arrogant.
He's quite literally an ass.
That's why it makes all the more sense that Puck accidentally turned him into an ass. Just his head.
Well, I placed him on his head. Sorry, there are certain things in that text that are just really wonderfully, wonderfully written out. And I think these are one of the few plays that, like, you need to hear it to better understand what's going on. I mean, all Shakespeare's plays have more depth when you, at the very least, hear what's going on.
Oh, most certainly.
This play, however, like, it doesn't matter if you stage it or not. There's no timeline. And I think that's another thing that is very interesting about this. Like, there's no timeline for what's going on here. It's supposed to take over, like, 2 or 3 days. But if you look out the layouts, like, how did all of this happen in one night? Like, it's a dreamscape, and it's very, very fun. So, it's a little bit more on the abstract side for what he does.
That's such a good word for it too, because I was literally just sitting here trying to think of a word other than you know what the critic said was just kind of ridiculous. Because
it is
such
ridiculous.
I got so confused when everybody's in the woods at the same time and they're all running around. I'm like, what is happening here? Like, I don't, what is happening? Like, that was literally all I could say is, oh my gosh. So, I mean, abstract is really a great word for it.
And it's kind of almost like three plays within one play,
and
because you've got the lovers and misinformation between Helena and Hermia, and you have, like,
the guy's pretending to be a lion, but saying that he's pretending to be a lion,
and
he's not going to die because he's going to pretend to die. Like, I'm like,
well, no, that's because the mechanicals, the players, they're doing a tragedy, and it's actually kind of this lampooning of a tragedy, because even within the play, people think that they're trying to make it into a comedy, and it's kind of almost like, it feels like this, like, throw out. I can't remember if this was written before or after Romeo and Juliet, but, like, Romeo and Juliet can be argued, I'm so sorry, I can't speak today, can be argued that that's a comedy. That is a dark comedy, that it is a parody on, like, lovesick teenagers who, like, are star-crossed lovers. And if you look at it, if you look at that text under that gaze, over the same treatment as the...
To answer your question, Midsummer Night's Dream was written exactly after Romeo and Juliet.
Okay, so there you go. So even, you may even can say that there's that coloring.
This context has the plays, they're chronicled in order to which they were written.
Well, it is interesting, too, that in the play, within a play here, right? I mean, it's very similar to Romeo and Juliet.
It's the star-crossed lovers, because there's a lot, like I said, there's a lot of those stories that were going around, and Romeo and Juliet is based off of Tristan and Isolde? I don't know how to pronounce her name, and I think that's what it's supposed to be loosely based off of. So, like, there's all these other stories that were around at the time, and these tropes and these characters, and the woebegotten star-crossed lovers is, like, a thing that happened. It was, like, a normal thing. Like, now that we have self-rescuing princess, which is a more modern trope, these were tropes that happened back then. So it could still be that, like, the popularity of Romeo and Juliet, or the thought process that went along with those characters, kind of translated over. Like, you have in Titus Andronicus, you have the one character, remember his name. It's been forever since I read it, but like that kind of one character who's like, I am evil and I know what I do is evil, that translates into one of the characters in Othello. So where he's saying that, you know, I know what I'm doing is wrong, and I can't remember his name too. I'm doing so terribly. Oh no, but if you know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about. Just follow along. I don't know. Right? You can be in the comment section like, yeah,
I gotta immerse myself in
Shakespeare. These are the characters' names.
Especially if I want to go on Jeopardy.
But yeah, like I'm terrible with names, so I'd be like, it's the person with the face. You know what I'm talking about, with the hair. You know, I turn into like a New York biddy. I don't know.
You mean the wife from Bob's Burgers?
Yes, I turn exactly. Yeah.
And it's that fashes.
Oh, you know, the one with the hair. Anyway, but so back to Shakespeare and talking about ridiculousness. But yeah, the play, this is, like I said, it's probably one of his fluffier things. It is one of his fluffier plays. But I don't think that detracts
from
it.
I've come to notice that I've taken his tragedies much more seriously, no puns intended. Comedies are meant to make you laugh, but in this case, the only difference between a comedy and a tragedy is
death.
Is yeah, whether or not the central character is better off in a comedy and worse off.
Yeah,
in
things
a tragedy.
Resolve themselves in his comedies, whereas in tragedies everybody's dead and there's at least one person who's like, look what happens when you don't follow the rules at the very end. It's like bad things happen when you don't do what you're supposed to.
But yeah, I for some reason I felt that after reading this, it's like I've seen this so many times before.
It was less creating complex characters, more flexing the literary muscle of being able to create beautiful, beautiful prose. And I think that's something that's very interesting. Like I said, like that one quote from the 1660s where the guy was like, it sucks. And then you jump to the 1840s where this other literary critic, Charles Gildon, said it's the most beautiful poetical drama that was ever written. And I think it's that flip-flop between the two is
so,
like,
I don't know
so
if,
funny because
I don't
it
know
had
if
enough time
that.
To mature.
I don't know if I'd say that because he resorted to rhyming very frequently.
I think that's another thing that why people say like this is supposed to be more of an abstract play is it's supposed to be playing with the thought process. It's also, I think, one of the first plays where like the fae are actual. Like they have interactions with the mortals and stuff like that. I feel like why can't I find what I wrote? I have so many notes everywhere. So the juxtaposition between you have these two worlds where it's the reality and the fairy world and the fairy realm where there's like chaos in both and, you know, discord, and you have the two kind of paralleling each other, which I thought was very interesting. And something else that's interesting, almost every single version of this play that I've seen, which I think is a convention that started with the original version of it, is you have Hippolyta and Theseus played, the same actors play Oberon and Titania. So you have those dualities. So you have the same actors who kind of flip-flop and play the same characters.
Interesting.
So, yeah. Because they're kind of these, like, secondary characters, and I think it's supposed to show the parallel between, like, the dream realm and the real world, and playing with that kind of fun stuff, because why not?
Yeah, that certainly
why
makes
not?
Sense to have.
So.
Okay.
Oh, it's like The Wizard of Oz, right?
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. It's those characters kind of are mirrored in that dream realm.
There's a little bit of difference between the two because A Wizard of Oz, it's clear that they were based off of the characters. In this case, we're not really sure. It's just an assumption that people make or parallel.
We have one king and one queen in both sides, so I see that the parallel kind of seems easy enough to me.
And then you have the fairies that are, it's not necessarily, and the fairies are somewhat, they seem very secondary. I think that the two major stories are between the lovers, Lysander and Hermia, Demetrius and Helena, and the, whatever you want to call them, the workers,
the mechanicals.
I was close enough.
They are the hard laborers.
Bottom and Quince.
Quince
and Peter Quill, yeah.
We're just going to list all the characters' names now. Yeah. Stand by, we're going to go through the entire cast.
Those were the two... Cobblet. Yeah, those were the two major... But then again, bottom story attachers to Titania.
Yeah, cobweb, peas, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Titania, yeah. So, I think it's a fun play. It's not something that you're supposed to take seriously. There's no, like, drama or grimness to it. It's a comedy, and it's one of the funner, lighter comedies of Shakespeare. And like I said, I think it's a very good example of the beautiful prose that somebody can put to paper. And it's a very... It evolves. When you're reading it on paper, it's kind of hard to follow along, but it's got rhyme, and it's fun. And
that's
where
Shakespeare gets his renown, is from his way he writes it, not what he writes.
Yeah, and then as soon as you put breath into it, there's this beautiful cadence that comes from it. It comes from the heart and is very, very transportive. You know, it can transport the audience from plain old wherever you're sitting into the forest, which is, I think, kind of fun, is that you get to go get lost in the woods with the characters. And I think that, at the very least, is done well. Maybe the plot is not done well. Maybe there is no plot. But you get to get lost for an hour or two in this wonderful world that is created with fairies and lovers and chaos. There's a lot of chaos in this.
Chaos.
And at the very end, you get to laugh. You get a little lighter. And you feel a little bit better about yourself at the end. It's beautiful.
It actually was very funny. The play within the play, I thought, was hilarious.
Yeah,
especially with all the dialogue about the wall.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, blessed wall.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, cursed wall. It was 5 seconds later.
In the show I got to interpret for, I had to interpret for the wall. And the person, like, you don't realize how many ways Shakespeare can say, I am a wall. I'm a wall. And there's me saying, like, I'm a wall. I'm a wall. I will leave out on the wall like seven different times.
Assigning the characters, and the one that was playing Pyramus is like, well, I could be the girl too.
That's what's really funny is, like, when you look at it, it's very, like, tongue in cheek. Okay, like, I think we've all known, like, if you're a theater person, you know that one person who is like, oh, just give me any role, I'll be good with, but I can do that role, but I can do that role, but I can do that role.
Just give me every role.
That'd be fine. Yeah, it's like, okay, this is going to be a one-man show. Everybody knows that, like, showboater.
Yeah.
So these, and I think that's what's fun about the mechanicals, is they're very human. Like, you have all of these whimsical characters that are fairies, and you know, they're wispy and ephemeral, and then you have these mechanicals where you have that dichotomy of running around the woods in a fever dream, and then these guys are like, okay, let's do this. Like, the space that can be created into something that's different, and it's kind of like a tip of the hat to theater in and of itself. And that's probably one of my favorite parts of the Shakespeare, is the fact that it can be very self-referential and very self-aware. And I feel like this play, even though it didn't have too much going on for it, was very self-aware that it was a play. Because especially when it's a play within a play sort of thing. Like, what other play am I thinking of? Hamlet is the one with the play within the play. Self-aware.
Yeah.
It's very self-aware. So Shakespeare knows exactly what he's doing with this. So maybe it's not necessarily as... profound as, I keep on saying King Lear because it's one of my favorite plays, but like, it's still very, very, it does its purpose in it, and it does it in all the right ways.
You know, his talent.
Yeah, he knows exactly what he's doing.
As a writer in general, like, he's great. Yeah.
I think that's about it on my
part. Do
you
have any final thoughts?
Okay.
Alrighty. How would we rate it? 0 to 5, half stars permitted, Larry?
I guess I'd go 3. I enjoyed it. 3.5. I'll say 3.5. I liked it. It's fun.
Jessica?
I have to agree. 3.5. I mean, I'm a big fan of Shakespeare and his works, and I like a lot of his tragedies. This was the first comedy I've read by him, so it wasn't, I don't know, I guess if I hadn't read the tragedies first, maybe I would have gotten more out of this. But, you know, like, it was just chaotic, so, yeah.
Tori?
I think you already know what I'm going to give it. I gave it a 5 because it's Shakespeare, and it's beautiful prose, and it's beautiful. It's a beautiful use of not having a lot, if that makes any sense. Like, you don't need a lot to have a good play. And this play has a lot of chaos and not a lot of substance, but it's still a wonderful, wonderful show to watch and show to read.
The only Shakespeare play that I actually ranked in the top 10 list for the year was Bath. that was back in 2015, but this is not going to go up there. I gave it a three or 3.5. I would say initially I'm leaning toward a 3. Maybe after today I may be convinced to bump my score up half a star, but I think that it was, I think that there were elements of it that were just so ridiculous and absurd, ridiculous and absurd can be a good thing, but when your backdrop is the same old thing, it's just the whole, the relations between the lovers, and the triangle, and the square, and the rectangle, and...
it was a lot to follow. It was just a lot to follow, I felt.
I think that it was a bit, I think that the substance, between those characters was a bit like an angel food cake.
Very light, yeah. Very sweet.
Not
a lot of substance.
Yes.
maybe I have to go and watch like a play. Maybe
that's what I'm saying.
It,
I feel like maybe this play is very different when at the very least if you listen to it or if you get to watch it, that's mm-hmm. great because it adds a whole other layer. It's easier to follow because literally like it'll. The one group will go off and the other group will come back.
I watched Finger Puppet Shakespeare twice.
Oh, there you go. So you've mastered it.
Reminds me, I'm going to leave a link down below to Books and Questions video for the Finger Puppet Shakespeare video that she did for Midsummer Night's Dream, where she explains the story.
Wait, who's this?
That's the name of her channel. It's called Books and Questions.
God, I'm so sorry.
And the way that it works, she has finger puppets for each of the characters, and she tells the story.
That's so wonderful.
And if anything happened,
I'm sorry.
If anything happened,
great visual image.
If anything happens to the character, for instance, once upon a time, Theseus and Hippolyta, they go over to
Hippolyta.
Go over to Aegisthus and convince. And then when it's time for Lysander and Hermia to come into the scene, she has finger puppets for them.
That's fantastic.
And then I'll leave a link down below, but. If you're interested in checking out Shakespeare, there are plenty of opportunities. Just buy this book.
That's everything. You're good. You
this
got
is every
it all.
Play that Shakespeare's written, from his histories to the very last history, King Henry VIII.
He's a chunky boy.
And
he's written some stuff.
If you're looking to get into his plays, this is very affordable. Be sure to join us next time for another episode of Literary Gladiators. For now, keep reading.